Хотите... Дима, 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 Дима!
Я в него потеряла в тот день, когда мы избрали Путина.
А вы избирали его?
Нет. Я не сошла с ума, чтобы выбирать человека из КГБ. Потому что мы достаточно уже старые люди и очень хорошо знаем, что бывает, когда к власти приходит эта организация.
Russia's stock market plunged a dramatic 14% after the arrest on Saturday of the country's most successful entrepreneur, Mikhail Khodorkovsky, the 40-year-old CEO of oil giant Yukos, was charged with tax evasion and fraud. He is viewed today as Russia's wealthiest man, reportedly worth $8 billion. A vocal opponent of Russian President Vladimir Putin and his government, Khodorkovsky has used some of his fortune to support opposition parties in the run-up to the December parliamentary elections. He is presently being detained in one of Moscow's highest security prisons.
Millions of our citizens увидели и услышали, что несмотря на заявление высшего руководства страны об укреплении правосудия, надеяться пока что не на что. Это стыд, позор и беда нашего государства. Я не признаю себя виновным и считаю свою невиновность доказанной.
There was an investor who in 2003 said that people are going to have forgotten Khodorkovsky in 2 years' time, everything's great, this doesn't mean anything. I mean, Khodorkovsky's personal history was in no ways black and white. But what happened should be the story of how Russia experimented with capitalism. Perhaps that experiment was a bit too fast and loose, that it did cause a backlash. And this is the man who is at the heart of it all.
There is one sign the Soviets can make that would be unmistakable, that would advance dramatically the cause of freedom and peace. Mr. Gorbachev, open this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
The Soviet economic transition, it was a transition from a real full-on centrally planned economy and a centrally planned economy where that economic structure was enforced at the end of the day by brutal secret police. In the 80s, any meaningful object was owned by the state. People got arrested for selling blue jeans. To go from that to a market economy, that's complicated.
All of a sudden, it was possible to do some black market operations and not face sanctions or jail for them. So there were sort of various factions within the Soviet power structure who would look for these people who were very talented, very sharp, very good at organizing people, but would not necessarily get anywhere if they tried to follow a traditional career. There was sort of this glass ceiling in particular for Jewish people, and there was a ceiling that was very hard to get beyond. So they were picked to some extent. And I think Khodorkovsky was picked. Gorbachev had signed a law in which you could now set up cooperatives, and students were at the forefront of that drive. Khodorkovsky was basically enrolled into setting up one of these first businesses. I'm not so clear on all the details, but they did start making money at a time when business was generally prohibited.
The market economy was this new and important thing that the kids got and the older people didn't. And Khodorkovsky was one of the kids that the older people trusted. Quite a rare thing in this moment when you saw the generations coming apart.
People in the Russian Federation just being transformed from totalitarian communist regime to some freedoms of normal life, of normal society. Of course, we would like to come to the stable situation as soon as possible so that Russia would be a democratic state with free elections, free media, human rights protected. And that gives even more, I would say, enthusiasm to us that we're doing the right things in the interest of majority of Russian people, and we know how to lead society to the better future.
Yeltsin and his team felt that they were revolutionaries, and they felt that they were revolutionaries who were overthrowing communism. There was a tremendous freeing up, a sense that you could do lots of things, you could grab for lots of things, particularly in the financial system, because there wasn't a financial system. And that really, for the Russian players, was the way that the first initial fortunes were made.
Khodorkovsky and his team set up one of the country's first banks, Amenatet Bank. It was the first bank to get a license for hard currency operations. Some of it is still a mystery, how they grew so fast and so quickly. You had to have connections, you had to have patrons. It's not quite clear to me where that patronage came from, but clearly they were seen as very talented. They were young wolves of Russia's capitalism.
There was a very new stuff for lawyers in Russia to do, namely the personal taxation. Because this year, basically, I believe the very first tax returns in Russia were filed in 93 for the year 92. So Khodorkovsky approached my partners of our law firm and asked to help with preparation of his tax return. The seniors at that firm, they probably knew even less than me about the issue and how to do that. So they sent me. So he realized how young I am, and he was asking questions like, who are you, where you graduated from, did you serve in the Soviet army, he'd ask me. I said, yes, he said, good.
The 1990s were a very traumatic time for a lot of Russians for whom the old certainties of the Soviet Union were taken away. The Soviet Union in many ways was a very grey place with lots of problems, but it did provide a kind of certainty. You had a job automatically, you had free healthcare, free education. All of that really fell away in the 90s. A lot of people's lives were turned upside down.
Against this backdrop, you had, in 1995, the knowledge that there would be another presidential election. Yeltsin and his team did not feel that a communist revanche in Russia was impossible, and that terrified them. Out of that terror came this idea that you would transfer the big remaining Russian natural resource assets, really the crown jewels of the Russian patrimony, to this very small handful of powerful businessmen. And in exchange for getting this property, they would support the government in the election.
Basically, these groups, by then known as oligarchs, were trying to restore these great Soviet industries which had fallen to rot and were about to collapse.
The official formulation was that these were loans they were making to the cash-strapped Russian state. And the official idea was they would then hold auctions at which the full ownership of the company would be determined, and that those auctions, allegedly anyway, were meant to be open. As it happened, each of the oligarchs, which initially loaned the money, ended up winning the auction in which the full ownership of the asset was transferred.
Khodorkovsky and his team managed to get hold of one of the biggest oil companies, Yukos. Not for very much, of course, sort of put the oil company back on its feet. Khodorkovsky told me once that he wanted to buy Yukos, but they didn't have funding initially, and they'd gone to Western partners and Western banks, but all the Western banks said, no way, it's too risky, because at that time, Yukos was the town where Yukos was based, Neftyugansk, was overrun by bandits. The oil company was in deep debt, so it was just an enormous amount of work. Khodorkovsky wasn't an oilman, he was a banker, he was a business administrator, but he would spend time in the field watching how drilling worked, and he would seek advice not just from Russian oilmen, but also from the West. They had a couple of corporate battles over how Khodorkovsky was getting control of the production units and at what price he was selling the oil, whether he was taking into account minority shareholders' interests. There were a lot of problems with corporate governance, but it was sort of shady times in Russian business in those days.
I mean, they are not angels, of course. And this was, again, Russia of you know, 90s. So it's a quite wild business environment. And they were playing by the rules of that time. And they were successful, which means they were able to find right ways to be successful in that environment. So I would never, and no one will say that they are innocent completely and they did nothing wrong.
The mayor of Neftyugansk, which is where Yukos had its main fields, he did write a letter to Boris Yeltsin at the time, sort of complaining that he basically called them murderous policies of Yukos, that they were killing the town because they were just choking off all sources of revenue and the town wasn't getting any. And soon after that, he did die after he sent that letter. I don't know whether it's true or not. I'm told that Khodorkovsky found out about it on his birthday. I'm told that when he heard, he was very shocked. He went white. And I'm not sure whether this was something that he knew about before it happened or whether someone in Yukos thought they were making a birthday present for Khodorkovsky. They got rid of some troublesome mayor. But it was a case that was never really closed. They'd find people and then witnesses they found would get killed or something like that.
We just never knew, and we don't really know. You know, it's certainly true that in the 1990s, a remarkable number of people died in business-related deaths. And that's partly because you had a collapse, even a surrender, by the state of a monopoly of control over coercive force. And so you had some of the oligarchs establishing these mini armies staffed by ex-KGB agents and people from the security forces. So you had great liberalization shading into anarchy at the edges.
Russia had an economic decline in the 90s, which was
the equivalent of the American Great Depression. It was that big.
Your savings were gone. Your pension was gone. And let's crucially bear in mind, you had this perception in the public mind that these incredibly lucky guys who had somehow talked their way into owning these vast assets were also, if not in the driver's seat of the Kremlin, certainly powerful backseat drivers.
Я ухаживал. Я сделал все, что мог. Мне на смену приходит новое поколение, поколение тех, кто может сделать больше и лучше.
In the year 2000, majority of Russians believed President Putin finally will continue to move in the direction of building up a democratic state with the market economy. And on that basis, we'll be in a position to stabilize the economy and to start resolving social problems. President Putin invited me to work with him as a prime minister. And of course, my responsibility was to move country to this direction.
When Putin came to power, he held this very famous meeting with the oligarchs in the middle of 2000, when he said essentially to them, you stay out of politics and you can keep your businesses, no matter how they were acquired in the 1990s. He also said that they had to be good corporate citizens and pay their taxes and stop bribing people. So it wasn't just staying out of politics. But that was the message. You behave yourselves and you can keep hold of your assets.
Putin came from one of the parts, one of the social or political classes, if you will, that was the most humiliated by the 90s, and that's the KGB. The KGB, in a sense, were the oligarchs of the Soviet era. There were a lot more of them. There weren't just six or seven, but they were really the ruling elite. So you came from this sort of peak of power and authority to total humiliation and lack of power in the 90s. And certainly from the point of view of a Khodorkovsky, and I would say, you know, to all of that group, Putin to them seemed inconsequential, not as smart as they were. Khodorkovsky was the one who expressed it to me most clearly in 1998. If a man is not an oligarch, he is not as good as we are. All of us had the same chances to begin with, and some of us seized those chances, and others didn't.
Really, he was just becoming ever more powerful, but because he was in touch with these Western bankers, he was convinced that he had to do something to raise the value of the company that was traded on the stock exchange, and to do that, he had to become the king of corporate governance, and he was one of the pioneers in making Russian company transparent. They were the first to issue quarterly GAAP accounts. They put independent Western directors on the board. They did a lot. And the value of UKUS went up dramatically because Western investors thought it was a safe place to invest.
Я в жизни разговаривал с Ходорковским всего один раз. И он расспрашивал меня о том, что же такое общественные организации. А правда ли, что люди в общественных организациях работают всего за 100 или за 200 долларов в месяц? Как это может быть? Что же у них за мотивация у этих людей? Спросил его, а, собственно говоря, а что вас-то в этом интересует? Для чего вам вот этот разговор со мной? Он сказал замечательную фразу. Вы знаете, у меня растут дети, И я очень хочу, чтобы мне было не стыдно перед моими детьми. Только я не знаю, как.
My name is Anton Drell. I'm a member of Moscow City Bar. I graduated Moscow State University Faculty of Law in 1992. I had some ordinary clients and unusual clients, but my life changed completely from 2000 year when Mikhail Khodorkovsky started to be my client. Ходорковскому было свойственно окружать себя молодыми людьми. Только этим я могу объяснить, что он предложил мне, юристу, к тому времени всего лишь с 10-летним опытом и практикой, а он к тому времени сходил уже в списки Форбса, предложил стать его личным адвокатом. И во-вторых, потому что я думаю, что... Я надеюсь, я думаю... Я не могу быть в этом уверен, что Ходорковскому показалось, что я понял, что он хочет от меня.
My university friends were the first Russian lawyers who started to go to the US or to the UK, to Europe and study law in these countries. So before that, really, you would never find a lawyer, a single lawyer in Russia, who knows how it is in the Western world.
Columbia Law School in New York organized for us meeting with Ted Kennedy, because Kennedy name in Soviet Union was miracle and mystical. But the most important personal for me, and I think for others, was meeting with extraordinary woman. It was meeting with Sandra Day O'Connors, member of Supreme Court of United States of America. Everybody from liberals thinks in United States that she was very conservative, but she was extremely principled lawyer. If I say I was impressed, I never say really big impress. Я четко знал, когда я был молодым, что настоящего правосудия в Советском Союзе не было. Я не знал о том, есть правосудие в Соединенных Штатах или где-то в Европе или нет, но то, что я увидел в Нью-Йорке, располагало меня к тому, что, наверное, все-таки в Америке его больше.
Education system wasn't in fact changed in the 90s when a lot of democratic developments happened. And in 2001, he launched Open Russia, public organization Open Russia, to educate as many people as he could about what democracy actually is and why it is good and why it is the driving force for economical development and personal development and everything.
He had his own institutions in the regions, TV station in Tomsk. He was funding children's youth movements. It was almost like a whole parallel Khodorkovsky world.
As I remember, Khodorkovsky was in that time, those time, was a young, richest and smartest man in this country, I thought so. Ходорковский там уже по стилю жизни был не такой, потому что у него не было яхт, у него там много чего не было, что, в принципе, является как бы таким стандартным набором олигарха. Ходорковский действительно прежде всего понимал, что для того, чтобы его там, например, дети и дети других людей жили дальше именно в нашей стране, вот в России, они уезжали жить за границу, там, в Англию, в Америку. А он не из тех людей, опять же, я уже говорила, которые бы уехали из России и жили где-то за границей, им было бы дальше там хорошо. Поэтому он хотел именно улучшить то, что вокруг него.
I remember working sort of 2000-2001, in the first years of Putin's presidency, and we were all thinking, this is going to be boring. Everything is sort of just progressing. Putin is making tax cuts, business is starting to boom, the oil price is going up. What can happen? The gangster capitalism of the 90s is over. These business barons have stopped shooting each other. They've learned to agree.
What was happening at that time, that Khodorkovsky was trying to create a mega oil company, and this is something that he was quite open about, and this was his ambition to actually create the best and the largest company in Russia by merging with Sibneft. And the merger actually was almost complete.
Yukos-Sibneft merger was a very big deal, of course, for the country. That merger were creating the biggest oil company, I think fourth in the world by reserves. And Khodorkovsky and his partners, they were prepared to sell 20%, 30% to a big American or whatever, European oil name like ExxonMobil or Chevron. And there were negotiations with these companies.
With Exxon, I think the deal was, this was that they would take 25% first with an option to increase the stake to a controlling one, perhaps further down the line in a couple of years. And they'd gotten so far. And even if they'd only stayed with a blocking stake, Khodorkovsky was going to receive a good deal of cash. It was going to be like $4 or $5 billion or something like that. And I just think that the concern was for Putin was, one, a US company is going to come in and take possible control of our biggest oil company, which would also mean that the state not only didn't have control over production anymore, but it didn't have control over how much was being exported. And that's a key lever of power in Putin's government. It's how they keep most of the oil business in line, because they have control over the pipeline system.
In February 2003, the president had this meeting. Khodorkovsky was talking about his plans to create this mega oil company and the need for the country to actually motivate its youth to get proper education, proper kind of jobs, etc. What he presented was the percentage of young people who started to prefer going into law enforcement agencies. And it was very clear, according to these numbers, that the youth understands that. At that kind of service, you would get a modest salary, but you would be exposed to getting huge benefits by other means, by sort of closing cases, opening cases. And the president himself should watch closely what is going on in his backyard, I would say. Putin was irritated and started to speak about corruption mechanisms that were used in the 90s, according to which all these private businessmen got their wealth. And he said, well, we didn't pay very close attention to that at that time, but now we're going to change that. And many people understood at that time that the president, given his background, the president would not tolerate that kind of behavior, actually.
Putin very clearly set out to put the oligarchs back into their box, as it were. And he achieved this by a couple of early attacks on oligarchs whom fled the country.
My dad basically told me that there was a scheme of how the top managers would replace each other in case of just any unpredicted situation. And he said that he had 10 people lined up from within the management of the company that, in case something happened, would replace him. And he said, trust me, you're not at least. Well, I mean, he was joking, but I still pretty much understood that my dad was really centered on running the company as efficiently as possible. And I really always trusted my father. I never questioned any of his decisions whatever he decided for himself, he was always very confident about what he was doing.
Khodorkovsky told me that there were some people in the Kremlin who wanted to take over UCAS. And I couldn't really believe him because they were on the front pages of all the business magazines. He was meeting with George Bush Sr., who was meeting with James Baker, and he had all this hold over Parliament, and it just seemed impossible that anyone would try to take him down. And I asked him whether he really believed it could happen, but he also said no. He said, I talked to Putin, and he said there's not going to be a review of assets, one in the 90s, and he said, I believe Putin. He said, Putin is a man of his word. He's not going to let this happen.
Мои родители, они, естественно, пережили революцию. Был голод, разруха. Потом наступил период НЭПа, это новой экономической политики. Когда, как мне рассказывала мама, на рынке появилось вот все как сейчас. Когда мама мне рассказывала, что она пошла на рынок и купила сразу там 10 яиц, и это было уже недорого, и мы, говорит, сделали с папой яичницу из 10 яиц, и это осталось на всю жизнь, что мы наелись после голодных революционных лет. А потом их всех расстреляли, посадили Лепманов. Поэтому я всегда говорю, что все вот эти годы, когда Миша уже работал, у меня приемник стоит даже в ванной комнате. То есть я включала утром, я открывала глаза, включала приемник и ждала новостей. И это не преувеличение, это действительно так. Я всегда ждала, что что-то будет.
There was a preparation of this special magazine called Who is Mr. X? And it just collected all the nasty things about Khodorkovsky that had ever been written and put it in one magazine.
Конечно, первое это было Khodorkovsky богат, он обокрал вас, русский народ. Но был, но очень есть и советский элемент, первый и важнейший. Khodorkovsky хотел продать Россию Западу. В России всегда был силен изоляционистский элемент. Особенно силен он был при Сталине. Понимаете, идея, что Khodorkovsky работает для наших врагов и хочет продать наши нефтяные богатства Америке, эта идея была абсолютно запущена сверху в народное сознание. Сознание было к этому готово.
One person was arrested, was a member of security service within UCAS, Alexei Pichugin. He was arrested and accused of murders, which was something that nobody expected, and nobody actually understood why it was done.
My husband was shot on June 26, 1998, on the day of Mikhail Khodorkovsky's birthday. From that day, the murder investigation has been put on hold until 2003, with the main murder site being controlled by UCOS, while the facts of the murder laid there on the surface.
Petukhov was gunned down in June 1998. Investigators allege the motive for the killing was Petukhov's attempts to recover taxes that UCOS owed to the city.
I mean, who knows what happened to Petukhov? There's a great deal of circumstantial evidence which would point to someone in UCAS being involved in that. But the evidence they had was sketchy at best, so then it became something political rather than something they'd actually found out.
После жалобы господина Пичугина о том, что к нему применялись незаконные методы допроса, включая использование наркотиков и допроса без присутствия адвокатов, медицинское освидетельствование, как утверждают его адвокаты, было произведено только через 8 дней и производилось сотрудником все того же следственного изолятора ФСБ.
July 2nd, Mr. Lebedev, Platon Lebedev, was arrested while in hospital. And that was quite shocking because, again, nobody for some reason expected that. And the thinking behind arresting Lebedev was that, all right, this is a financial person, he's weak, he's not a courageous man, and so we will break him easily and he will tell us everything about the finances.
Как руководителю компании, так сказать, договариваться не о чем. Я готов сделать любые шаги, которые зависят от меня, для того, чтобы люди, незаконно, на мой взгляд, задержанные, оказались на свободе.
Khodorkovsky announced that he was planning actually to go into politics eventually, because what is happening around his company and around his partners, he's not going to tolerate that. He needs to be actively involved in somehow changing the situation. So he's waiting for our advice in terms of making the switch. So I was quite forcefully saying that I don't think it's a good idea for him to get into politics just yet, and that he will need probably two or three years to completely switch from his business activities to open Russia as a charitable and educational leader figure, whatever, and be that for a while and prove that he can do that. But he felt completely understandably he had no time.
In September of 2003, I just came to college. And then after a couple of weeks, my dad came in. He was on a business trip in the United States and he was on his way to Washington. So he stopped over in Boston for one night actually. So we just went out that night for a brief chat, and in the morning he saw my school, and I introduced him to my girlfriend at the time. So I asked him, what's going on? What's happening to you? Because what are your plans? And he said, listen, they have taken my close friend and my good business partner, Platon, in prison already, and they've made several threats to the existence of Yukos. And listen, he said, like, the only thing that is left to do is to put me in prison. I'm like, well, what are you gonna do about it? Are you still coming back? And he's like, well, yeah, I'm still going back, because that's, they're brave enough, that's the last thing that's left for them to do. So I didn't question his decision. Frankly, I didn't have time. This conversation was in the car when we were going to the airport together. So I said, well, I'll see you soon.
Если они хотят, чтобы я стал политэмигрантом, я не стану. Если они хотят, чтобы я сел в тюрьму, при сегодняшней системе вот поведения, которое сейчас нам демонстрируется, это легко, пожалуйста, могут сделать. Речь о деньгах как таковых не идет, потому что когда компания в год платит 4 миллиарда долларов налогов, так сказать, то вопрос о изъятии или неизъятии тех или иных дополнительных средств решаются с помощью налоговой системы.
В воскресенье поздно вечером я, к слову сказать, первый раз попал к нему домой и был поражен, скромностью быта, реальной скромностью быта. И это было в районе половины 12-12 ночи, 12 ночи. Он сказал, что нам нужно поговорить. Мы поговорили о каких-то не очень значительных делах. И затем он говорит, имейте в виду, что вероятность своего ареста я расцениваю процентов 70-80. У моей первой реакции ему, естественно, было посоветовать, да что вы, да уезжайте. Он мне тогда ответил, вы что, смеетесь? Вы даже не понимаете, что вы советуете и в какой ситуации я нахожусь. То есть он даже обсуждать это не хотел. Ну, во-первых, я, честно могу сказать, не поверил, потому что если человек в здравом уме говорит, что процентов на 70-80 его арестуют, у него есть все возможности уехать из страны, он уезжает, а не остается. Поэтому я не очень этому поверил, честно могу сказать.
Ходорковский собирался в Иркутск принять участие в конференции, организованной Open Russia Foundation. И, собственно говоря, я как раз полетела в командировку в Иркутск для того, чтобы там как-то помогать в организации этой конференции. И еще у нас было там запланировано одно большое интервью на телевидении иркутском. Когда вот-вот уже должен был прилететь Ходорковский к нам, в какой-то момент пресс-секретарь губернатора мне говорит... Интервью не будет на телевидении, и вообще Ходорковского здесь не будет. Ну, понятно, пресс-секретарь губернатора Иркутска не может знать о передвижении Ходорковского, просто потому что, ну, это совсем разные сферы, он не работает. Поэтому я позвонила в нашим знакомым в ЮКОС, и мне как раз в тот момент сказали, что вот Ходорковский только что на пути в Иркутск был арестован.
Russian commandos today seized Russia's richest man from his plane in Siberia and took him to a Moscow court. Oil tycoon Mikhail Khodorkovsky was ordered jailed on fraud and tax evasion charges.
Звонился. Ходорковский взял трубку мобильного, сказал: я не могу говорить, я перезвоню попозже. И все. Он уже был, как я понимаю, в суде с Антоном, то есть когда мера пресечения избиралась.
Ходорковский не признал себя виновным, и признать себя виновным в тех обвинениях, которые ему выдвинуты, невозможно. Это полный абсурд.
Я на тот момент был его единственный адвокат, естественно, я была реальная его связь с внешним миром, реальная связь с его родственниками, с его женой, с его детьми, с его родителями. Себя как-то смотрел немножко со стороны, как в каком-то кино, было ощущение какого-то кино. Кино, потому что, ну, постоянно, каждую минуту что-то происходило, какие-то звонки, тысячи журналистов, тысячи его знакомых. Я думал, ну вот что сейчас нужно делать юридически, нужно все очень правильно делать, потому что я был абсолютно уверен в том, после прочтения обвинительного заключения, что это полная ерунда. И первые слова, которые я сказал журналистам после выхода из суда, который утвердил его арест, это абсолютно политическое дело. И то, что я слышал в закрытом заседании, ну, в общем, подтверждало правоту моих слов.
Михаил Борисович, держаться! Держаться!
They suddenly open a tax case against him. They said he owed more than $30 billion. They also claimed Khodorkovsky and Lebedev headed an organized crime group.
Лишь несколько сценариев. И один из основных — это самый плохой сценарий. И для себя тоже, и для людей, которые тебя окружают. И мы как раз, когда пили виски, рассматривали всякие плохие сценарии тоже, и кто-то из ребят, который там был, сказал, что вы понимаете, что если его будут судить, его, то нас тоже будут судить как преступную группировку, потому что все, кто работал на него, автоматически становятся в чем-то тоже виноватыми, скажем так.
На следующий мы с ним встретились уже в суде, то он мне на мой вопрос, ну чё ж вы не уехали-то? Он ответил, я хочу жить в нормальной стране. Это раз. И два, ну, во-первых, я ему сказал, что вы понимаете, Михаил Борисович, это надолго. Он сказал такую фразу, где было одно слово по-английски. Ну что ж, такой экспириенс мне тоже не помешает.
An element in Khodorkovsky's calculation was that the only way someone like him could play a political role in Russia was to stand up to persecution by the state. He felt that would in some way transform him in the public perception from a thieving, greedy, corrupt oligarch to a brave dissident voice standing up to the Kremlin.
In Russia, the row enveloping the country's biggest oil company, Yukos, is threatening to split the government.
Mr. Putin had ordered his government to keep out of the affair, but today, an unprecedented act of defiance from his own prime minister. Mikhail Kasyanov publicly announced he was deeply concerned at the prosecutor's decision to freeze more than 40% of Yukos shares.
I got an understanding that the real reason was that Khodorkovsky was not in a coordinated manner financed political parties, not only liberal parties, which he personally, Mikhail Khodorkovsky, described to me that he got authority, or I would say permission to finance liberal parties, but also he financed Communist Party and some left organizations too. And that, as appeared to be, was the real reason.
Once Khodorkovsky was arrested and taken out of the way, big business stopped financing any opposition parties. There was only one party to which anyone showed any fealty, unless you wanted to end up in jail, that's United Russia or the Kremlin parties.
The Bush administration, which is called Putin an ally, raised the caution sign.
We think the Russian authorities need to dispel concerns that Yukos' case is politically motivated.
Теперь, что касается упомянутого вами дела Юкоса и по поводу того, какие сигналы мы хотим послать обществу, есть только один сигнал. Во-первых, это не мы его посылаем, а Генеральная прокуратура.
A lot of other things were happening, starting with Duma elections, where all these oppositional parties didn't get any seats, and the elections were clearly manipulated. You could see.
3 weeks before elections, the government was fired, and President Putin launched a set of different laws which squeezed political and civil rights of people, and that appeared to be that was a real deliberately chosen way. To that end, I can say that Yukos and Khodorkovsky case, that was a first serious signal to the society that Russia was going to change its course.
You saw former independent journalists, former investigative journalists on the TV who used to be, you know, the Democrat, the main, you know, voice for revelations about the Soviet regime or something. And this person would speak about something completely crazy, like, you know, Khodorkovsky plotting murders or NGOs being paid for by American spies. And as increasing number of people were doing things like that, you would think, okay, well, probably it's me who's doing the crazy thing. they're not doing crazy things, they're doing the right thing. And I'm the one who's wrong.
Я все-таки питал некую иллюзию, что есть некие барьеры, некие границы. У меня ничего такого в офисе не было на самом деле. Но когда ко мне пришли в офис без судебного решения, меня туда не пустили, разгромили офис, забрали все папки, в том числе материалы по подготовке к Европейскому суду. А потом на всю страну начальник управления общественных связей Генеральной прокуратуры России объявила о том, что обыска у меня не было, потому что, оказывается, это не мой офис. При том, что у меня на столе стояла фотография жены и фотографии детей. Или возьмем ситуацию с обысками. Три раза у меня были обыски. Во время третьего обыска мне было прямо сказано, ничего мы такого не ищем, нам надо поставить галочку, что вот мы пришли, испугали тебя.
Anton was a lawyer in our law firm. So I started to figure out what we can do and what connections we can use to survive. And the informant, as we call this guy, because we want to keep his anonymity, he's, you know, he's a former KGB general. I said, look, can you really, because something is going on, something very bad for us, so can you check? And he came back in 2 weeks and said, look, guys, you're in a big trouble because there is an instruction to destroy your firm completely.
We were educated about similar cases in the past. We understood that we have to really show to the world the real picture of what is going on. And that was why we formed the press center for his lawyers. We were very enthusiastic because we believed that if the whole world sees how unfair he's being treated, he would win, if not this legal case, but the court of public opinion, they say.
They were started to call employees, lawyers, assistants, and interrogate them. So I came to the interrogation of one of the employees, a girl from our office, as a lawyer, acting, representing her. And that investigator then just turned to me and said, well, now I want to interrogate you. And I said, how is this possible? I mean, I'm here as an attorney representing the client. I mean, this is the formality of the, of course, we know the reality, but the formality is that, that this is the law. So it's just blatant violation of law. And he said, well, I have an instruction. And let's violate the law then. I have an instruction, and minutes after he, in some other context, I don't remember the details, but in some other context, he said, I have an authority to arrest you right now, right here. You will not leave this building unless you will give me the incriminating evidence. Literally, I said, do you want me to tell you how I was taking the money out of Yuka's accounts and bringing in the big bags to Khodorkovsky? You want me to tell you that? Something like this. You know, it's never happened, so let's be realistic. I've signed this statement. He took it into the fax machine, put it in the fax machine and sent. And everything was clear. He was sending this to someone superior. And then we were drinking tea with him, you know, talking socially. And then he made a phone call, I believe, to the superiors, and he understood that there's simply no one there. So there's no person on top of him to read this statement. And then he said, well, that's okay. Thank you, you can go. Thanks God, I can go.
He didn't come home. I was waiting and waiting and waiting and trying to call him, but he didn't answer. And then, like at midnight, he called and he said that he's in the city where his grandmother was born. You know, and it was right, because now we know that our phones were bugged. I'd say this night, it was the most awful night of my life, because I understood that all our life changed in this moment.
This investigator started to call me. And over the phone, he said, we want you to come back, otherwise people may suffer. That was his direct words. People may suffer.
Prosecutors came to our house. Two big vans surrounded the house, and 10 more people were inside.
During that search, they found tickets because my wife bought tickets to go to join me in New York.
Everything seemed to be okay until we got to registration desk. And in a few minutes, five or seven people in suits came with my documents and they asked, are you Екатерина Гурьянова? And I said, yes. They said, you need to go with us to the police station inside the airport. We have information that you are transporting a big amount of drugs.
I was in the court, Khodorkovsky and Lebedev trial, and suddenly I read a SMS message from my wife. Anton, just now Katya called me. She arrested with her children in Sheremetyevo airport. Immediately, of course, I said about it to Khodorkovsky and Lebedev. I was shocked. It was a shock for him too, because it was first time when эта волна подавления и насилия коснулась членов семьи.
The questions that they asked me was, do I know who can send them the information that I'm carrying the big amount of drugs? I said, you searched my luggage, there is nothing there. He said, I know, but we have this information and we have to go with us. I said, I need to go to my flight. They said, that's okay. Your flight is delayed, it's okay. You'll be on time. And then in 1 hour more, they released me from the office. When I was back to the registration desk, Aeroflot representatives said to me, the registration is closed. That's it, you cannot fly this flight. And I heard this person from phone ask about me. Do I cry or do I scream or what I do?
She called me and I said, look, you need to take any flight, fast as possible, any flight. Go to Switzerland, go to London, just go, buy tickets and go.
When finally I was in passport control, my name was in this list of persons who cannot leave the country. Officer, she said, I will call upper officer. He came to this line and he tried to speak by phone with somebody, but I think probably it was too late. I mean, in the night, and they didn't have, I don't know, further instructions. That's why they took this risk to let me go. All this time, I asked myself, what it was, what it is, this situation. Maybe I should go home, but you don't know. Maybe just outside the airport, a big truck is waiting for your car and it will crash your car. You know, you cannot be sure if something like this happens.
the way they treated them inside the court, the way the journalists were kept from coming in when there were fences built and military forces not letting anyone in except for the lawyers. It was already clear that nothing good is going to come out of this. But he had this statement prepared for the worst outcome, and this statement was read by Anton on the steps of the court.
И миллионы наших сограждан увидели и услышали, что несмотря на заявление высшего руководства страны об укреплении правосудия, надеяться пока что не на что. Это стыд, позор и беда нашего государства. Я не признаю себя виновным и считаю свою невиновность доказанной.
Я в него потеряла в тот день, когда мы избрали Путина.
А вы избирали его?
Нет. Я не сошла с ума, чтобы выбирать человека из КГБ, потому что мы достаточно уже старые люди и очень хорошо знаем, что бывает, когда к власти приходит эта организация.
My dad was overly optimistic. He did not doubt the president. He did not doubt the judicial system. He did not doubt his certainty that we have passed the point of no return, that we could not go back to how things were. Just less than at that time, 15 years ago, he just thought that it was over.
Khodorkovsky told me in our direct conversation that one of the reasons why he stay in Russia. Это Платон, of course. Я помню прекрасно, когда мы вышли с Ходорковским после допроса в прокуратуре. Он еще, это было в июле, это было через два дня после ареста Лебедева. И Ходорковский мне так, кашлянув в сердцах, сказал, никогда себе не прощу, что позволил им посадить Платона. Что пропустил этот момент. Наверное, надо было как-то предупредить. Я не понимал этого, но никогда себе это не прощу.
You would think that something like this should not happen, could not happen, and think Khodorkovsky also believed could not happen as well. That sort of a move toward a market economy could not be, so a real free market economy could not be dismantled so quickly. But all of a sudden, these people came to power who decided perhaps that they hadn't had a cut of the pie, that the oligarchs were still too powerful, and they wanted control of the economy themselves. And almost overnight, the whole country changed.
The problem is that I think what happened is that initially Khodorkovsky quarreled not with Putin himself, but with people around Putin. And the problem is that Putin's friends, they all come from secret services, and they're not really people who know how to do business or even how to rule the country. They know how to destroy enemies. If there are no enemies, they must be thought out. But they managed, these friends, to persuade Putin that Khodorkovsky is the enemy of Putin, that he wants to be a president, that he wants to write parliament, that he wants to run Duma. Actually, Khodorkovsky was trying to make Russia a more transparent country. Not even because he wanted to become a president, but because he understood that transparency is necessary to increase the net asset value of his company. Okay, he was taking assets from other people by force, by ruse, by paying bribes. But he've got these assets. Now he needed to increase their value. So he started going transparent. And of course, this wish of his
was really incompatible with the intention of people who started ruling the country under Putin. They didn't need transparency. They needed the control over the companies.
December the 19th last year, Yukos's main oil fields, which had been seized by the Russian state, were sold off. Journalists barred from the auction room watched a live TV feed. A company no one had heard of, Baikal Finance Group, was the only bidder. The price, $9 billion, marginally above the state's reserve. The auction completed in the space of 6 minutes.
The previously unknown Baikal Finance Group submitted a winning bid of $9.35 billion, estimated to be only half the market value of Ugansk Neftgaz, the most valuable subsidiary of oil giant Yukos. The prominent state-run oil company Rosneft subsequently purchased the enigmatic Baikal. On an even more intriguing note, Rosneft has plans to merge with the largest government-controlled energy company, Gazprom.
Все вы прекрасно знаете, как у нас происходила приватизация в начале 90-х годов. И как, используя различные уловки, в том числе нарушающие даже тогда действовавшее законодательство, многие участники рынка тогда получали государственную, многомиллиардную государственную собственность. Сегодня государство, используя абсолютно легальные рыночные механизмы, обеспечивает свои интересы. Считаю это вполне нормально.
Yukos belonged to Khodorkovsky and oil belonged to Khodorkovsky. Now it is transported, now it went allegedly to the state, but the head of the council of directors of the new company is Mr. Sechin, deputy head of president's administration and the closest friend of President Putin. And actually this guy, you can say that he's number one in Russia, but you cannot say that he's number two. And the guy who exports the Yukos oil is another friend of president, and he controls an export company called and its value seems to be around $20 billion. And of course, the real question behind this is, okay, these two guys, not the state, but these two guys, have profited personally from the fact that Yukos has been taken from Khodorkovsky and given to somebody other. They have billions of profits. Now, President Putin has spoiled his reputation, has spoiled his image because of this case. It's either he's so generous because he's given billions of dollars to his friends and spoiled his reputation because of this. Either he's not too generous and these two people are just figureheads.
Igor Sechin became chairman of Rosneft just as it was starting to move in on Yukos. Rosneft has taken over Yukos now and almost in its entirety. Sechin's also seen as someone who helped plot Khodorkovsky's downfall. We don't know if that's true or not.
Some people talk about it even as being a new oligarchy. In the sense that politics and business have merged. But this time, it's not, as it was in the 1990s, businessmen becoming politicians. It's the other way around. It's politicians, people in the Kremlin, in essence, becoming businessmen by chairing very large state companies.
There's a guy called Sergei Chimizov, who's a close ally of Putin. They worked together when Putin was a KGB agent in Dresden. Sergei Chemizov was also working as an agent in Dresden at that time. And he now heads this huge state corporation called Russian Technologies. And it was formed on the base of the state arms export. And there's Viktor Ivanov, another close aide. He's on the board of the National Airline. He also chairs the board of Almaz Ante, which is a producer of missile defense mechanisms. And now Putin has tight control of this very key strategic company. And there's Dmitry Medvedev, who is very loyal aide to Putin, and now his Putin successor, who's been chairman of Gazprom since 2000, 2001.
Я думаю, что вот это, ну, скажем так, молодежь, которая
вот это все не знала, ни 37-го года, ни всех этих, то, что у нас было, они не поняли всей опасности, которая будет. Что человек из органов, которые у нас всю жизнь были, ну, в общем, олицетворением все-таки несчастья страны, пришедшей к власти, ничего хорошего не будет. Мы-то, собственно, 37-й год я тоже не помню, но, во всяком случае, я знала уже людей, которые это пережили, которые были в лагерях. Вот таких было очень много знакомых. А они только из книг это знали, а это мало.
Меня за 3 месяца до ареста пригласили там куда-то к власти и предложили эмигрировать. Если бы я вам сейчас скажу, что я героически отказался эмигрировать, я навру. Мне очень не хотелось быть арестованным. Но еще больше я не хотел эмигрировать. И это моя страна. Вот во мне очень сильно чувствую, что это моя страна, это мое отечество. Я не могу из него уехать насильно. И вот когда я услышал эти слова от Ходорковского тогда, в 2001 году, который он сказал о том, что он не хочет, чтобы ему было стыдно перед детьми, я услышал в нем, вот в его интонации, вот это же ощущение. Это моя страна.
They filed new charges against Khodorkovsky. He's now charged not just with embezzlement and tax fraud, but now with money laundering and with stealing $30 billion worth of oil revenues.
The initial charges that were brought against Khodorkovsky, Russians could look at those and say, well, those kind of things were going on in the 1990s. You know, even the international community could perhaps look at those and say there was a lot of stuff going on in the 1990s. Maybe he did it. Probably he did it. But with the new charges, the idea that virtually the entire revenues of UKOS, the entire oil output and revenue of UKOS was somehow being embezzled by its management, I think is something that a lot of people have much more difficulty comprehending or imagining could be possible.
It's not clear still why on earth they're filing those new charges, because they already have him in jail for 8 years, but he was due to get early release because he'd served half his sentence, so they needed to make sure he was going to stay there.
Может быть, самое важное, что сделал в своей жизни Ходорковский, это две вещи. Во-первых, сел в тюрьму, когда мог не сесть. И во-вторых, вместо того, чтобы написать покаянное письмо и выйти на свободу, написал несколько своих статей. Вот его статья о том, что все-таки нужно как-то примирить закон и справедливость. Что не может в России развиваться нормальная собственность, если эта собственность не будет легитимна в глазах народа. И надо как-то это легитимировать. Нужно что-то сделать. Нужно найти способы более справедливой жизни. Он думает о жизни страны. Конечно, если ты будешь в тюрьме думать о жизни страны, вместо того, чтобы писать письмо «Я во всем виноват, простите меня, отпустите меня», то, конечно, это не способствует тому, чтобы его освободили.
Для понимания того, на что может решиться власть для достижения своей цели, я так скажу. Когда-то на мой день рождения всегда собиралось очень много народу. И там больше половины было тех, с кем мы учились, работали, юристы. Другая половина юристами не было. Вот когда я отмечал свой день рождения в прошлом году, я посчитал, что я не досчитался там трети друзей. И я даже слышал, что есть такая версия в Генеральной прокуратуре, что устойчивая организованная преступная группа юристов и адвокатов, вовлеченных в дело ЮКОСа, сложилась еще в середине 80-х годов в Московском университете, хотя в обвинении этого не написано. И я прекрасно помню разговор с еще одним нашим общим другом, бывшим начальником юридического департамента ЮКОСа Василием Алексаняном, за три дня до его ареста, когда он сказал, ну, скорее всего, не посадят, предъявят обвинение. Ну, ладно, как-то вот чего я поеду. Вот, его посадили, он сидит, и он в очень плохом состоянии. У меня есть надежда, что этот фильм не увидят его родители, но у меня нет уверенности в том, что он сможет дожить до выхода.
Mikhail Khodorkovsky is in the headlines again. The imprisoned former CEO of UCOS is on hunger strike. He says he is standing by former UCOS executive Vasily Alexanyan, his colleague who is reportedly dying of AIDS in prison.
The investigators said that we can put you in hospital and give you treatment if you say what we need. He said, these are innocent people and I cannot buy my life by telling a lie. And
я арестовал его только потому, что мне назначили на должность исполнительного вице-президента компании. И я вступил в процесс по банкротству 27 марта. В заседании я участвовал как представитель компании. Меня полтора года, 14 раз допрашивали. Никаких претензий. Вообще ничего. В деле нету даже документов, ни одних, которые меня бы хоть как-то связывали с этими событиями вообще, которые мне инкриминируют. Вот, надо было убрать человека, взяли, убрали. Что говорить об этом? Типичная ликвидация. Если раньше расстреливали, сейчас по-другому делают.
Essentially, this hunger strike, I think, contributed to the fact that Alexanyan was finally transferred from the prison to hospital.
Не исключено, что повлияла голодовка Ходорковского. Будем циничны, два трупа им не нужно. Я четко знал, когда я был молодым, что настоящего правосудия в Советском Союзе не было. Однако я должен признать сейчас, что теперь я понимаю, что даже в Советском Союзе 70-х, 80-х годов правосудие было больше, чем в нынешней России.
I can repeat Vasily's words. You live and you think that it will never happen to you. But when it comes to you, you must understand that it can happen to anyone. And this is not because of some accidents or God's will or something like that. It happens when laws don't work, when there is no justice, and justice is used like a hammer to crush something that didn't fit someone's model of life or state or something like that. Don't think it's over the ocean. Don't think it's other continent. It's close, it's very close. It will come to you.
В ближайшее воскресенье, 2 марта, состоится важнейшее политическое событие. Выборы президента нашей страны. 3 месяца назад мы с вами избрали новый парламент, и он уже активно работает. А послезавтра нам предстоит проголосовать за нового президента. И тем самым завершить второй и решающий этап обновления высшей власти. И кто принесет на посту главы государства реальную пользу миллионам людей, всем гражданам нашей великой Родины. В эти дни у каждого есть возможность самостоятельно ответить на эти вопросы. И на выборах президента России сделать свой осознанный выбор. Thank you.
almost 2 years in the court, 4 years investigation, 7 years in jail and labor camp. This is Mikhail Khodorkovsky closing statement. I remember at the end of the 80s, when I was 25 years old, our country was filled with the hope of freedom, hope that we could attain happiness for ourselves and our children. Most likely, our entire generation, including myself, bears responsibility for the fact that these hopes were not fully realized. It is difficult for me to live in prison. I don't want to die here, but if I have to, I will not hesitate.